Take your Bibles today and turn, will you please, to the book of Romans, chapter 13. Romans, chapter 13, and I'm reading from page 1207. While you're turning there, let me say just a word or two about our daily broadcast. If you're not getting the daily broadcast, if you tune to this station where you're now listening, you can get the broadcast at 12 o'clock noon, Monday through Saturday. I hope you're getting it. If not, tune in and get it if you can. I have here in my hand a little leaflet. I ought to supply these. It came out in the Reader's Digest, but I saw it was so needful, I ordered a supply. I thought I'd send out at your request, if you'd like to have a copy. It's entitled, Warning to a Teenage Girl, Cigarettes Can Kill You. And this gives a story of a very beautiful, lovely young teenage girl that started smoking in her teens, and it tells how it marred her beauty and how it shortened her days and wrecked her health. Now, you teenage girls, if you are smoking, if you have that habit, shame on you. You're destroying your beauty, you're shortening your days, you're ruining your health. And the same thing can be said about teenage boys as well. I'll be glad to send you this leaflet at your request. Just write in and say, Preacher Edwards, send me the leaflet pertaining to the cigarettes and the teenage girl. I'll be glad to do so. And then if you want some of our cassette tape, now today cassette tape is number 170 is the tape for today, 170. And just requested, I'm going to speak on the subject, rebelling against authority and respecting authority. We'll send you a list of more than 160, and you can select the ones you'd like to have. We send them out for a gift of $3 each, and the gift is used to help defray the radio expense. And my mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is a zip code number. We covet your prayers. We would like to hear from you. Now, I do hope you have that Bible open at Romans chapter 13. I'm going to bring a needy message today. Preachers don't like to bring messages necessarily along this line, but we must. We must preach the whole counsel of God, and God's true servants do that. We can't draw back any punches. We can't call out and select just love sermons. And we like to talk about the love of Jesus, and some preachers, that's all they talk about. It reminded me of the new modern pastor that went to the church, and he was one of these liberals. And one of the ladies, a few months after he came to the church, someone asked her how that she liked the pastor. She said, he's just so wonderful. Said, I've learned to love everything since he's been here. I learned even to love the devil. And said, I didn't know what sin was till he came here. Well, you need to realize that you can't love everything. There's a limit, and you must keep that in mind. God's men preaches the whole counsel of God. And you need to realize that. And we got to give the bitter with the sweet and the salt with the sugar and so forth. And Romans chapter 13. Let every soul be subject unto the high powers. For there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resists the power resists the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is a minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is a minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore you must needs be subject not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. That's reading from Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. Now we know that sin is on the increase. The Bible tells us so, that it would be in the end time. And you know that by reading your newspapers, by listening, of course, to your news on the radio and TV and whatnot. And you know that there's much sin in the land. It's getting worse all the time. And we're living in the last days, and the spirit of the Antichrist is very prevalent in the land today. And that spirit of the Antichrist is, of course, rebellion. I've told you that many times. Antichrist would be a self-willed individual. No doubt about it in my mind. I can't prove it, but I believe he's alive in the land today. That's why you feel see the spirit of the Antichrist working in every field and every phase of life today. Now let me give you some alarming statistics about teenagers, and this is taken from the Sword of the Lord, September the 9th, 1983, and I quote, "The top offenses in public schools of the class of 1940 were talking in class, chewing gum, making noise in class, running in the halls, getting out of turn in lines, wearing improper clothing, and not putting paper in the wastebasket. The top offenses in national public schools for the class of 1983 were rape, robbery, assaults, burglary, arson, bumming, murder, suicide, absenteeism, abortion, vandalism, extortion, drugs, drug abuse, gang warfare, venereal disease, pregnancies." According to the research newspaper, it says Longview, Texas, the 19 million high school students in America are in trouble already. 15% of the 65 million people under 18 have serious mental, emotional problems. Last year, one out of every 10 teenage girls got pregnant. 55% of all black babies are born out of wedlock, and the average mother is only 16. The federal government estimates now 3 3/10 million problem drinkers between the ages of 14 and 17. Suicide is the second greatest killer among high school students. Violence is on the rise. The students of the 80s has little or no discipline. The average high school graduate has watched 15,000 hours of television. He spent 12,000 hours in the classroom. He's seen 30,000 commercials, 18,000 murders on TV, and there are now 1 million runaway teenagers years between the ages of 15 to 17, and 30 teenagers suicides today in America. Then it says half of all patients in mental hospitals, 21 years of age or younger, according to 17 magazine. 43% of teenage girls believe there's nothing wrong with premarital sex. 36% of high school girls intend to live with a man before marriage or have already done so. The latest survey shows before they are out of their teens, 80% of the boys and 70% of the girls have had sexual intercourse. 3 out of every 4 teenagers receive no regular religious instruction. You see the direction in which we're headed, and we need to try to do all we can to curb it, to stop it, to do what we can to instruct and to help our young people as they sojourn. Now, God places men in authority. They're God's ministers. I just read in my text there how that God places men in authority as his ministers in government and so forth. And we need to see what God has to say about it. Now, Satan's rebellion against God brought about his downfall. That was the beginning of rebellion, rebelling against authority. One of the greatest sins of America today is rebellion against authority. You know that. In Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 15, the Bible said, "Heart thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. Heart thou cut down the ground, which didst weaken the nation. Thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, the sides of the pit." Now we find the beginning of the rebellion, of course, had its beginning with the devil yonder in heaven. At one time he was Lucifer, the archangel, but now he's become the devil. And so he was cast out of heaven because of his rebellion against God. That was the beginning of it. And from that time, since God placed man in the garden and expelled him from the garden, man has been in rebellion against God and against authority. Now we have rules, and these are to rule in fear of God. Rulers are to rule in fear of God, according to the Bible. In 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 3, the God of Israel said, "The rock of Israel spake to me, he that ruleth over men must be just and rule in the fear of God." Now, according to the Bible, every man that's placed in authority whether he be the President of the United States, whether he be a senator or a congressman, whether he be a mayor or governor, whether he be a judge or a police officer, he's to rule in the fear of God. That authority has been placed in his hands, on his shoulders, and he has that responsibility. The President of the United States is not only going to give an account unto God for his soul when he dies, but he'll give an account unto God as to how he judged and how he operated and carried out his administration the time he was in authority. Every president, every senator, every congressman must give an account unto God for his administration, for what he does inside of God and what he does in regard to humanity when he dies. Every governor of every state is going to give an account unto God for his soul. He'll give an account unto God as how he acted and how he enforced his administration while he was in power. And so will every mayor, and so will everyone that's placed in authority by the people. They have that responsibility. Now the Bible plainly tells us that we're to pray for these people. Pray for them. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 through 3, I exhort therefore that first of all supplications, prayers, intercessions, giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty, for this is good and acceptable in sight of God. God demands or commands us to pray for these people in authority. And if they fail to do that which is right, they'll most certainly give an account unto God for it in the day of judgment. There's an organization in America today that's very dangerous as far as I'm concerned personally. It's called the ACLU. As far as I'm concerned, it's America's Cranky Lunatic Union, America's Crime Loving Union, and they're doing much damage in the land today. It's a very dangerous organization, and it's doing a lot of damage in the land. It's turning loose criminals, it's fighting for the release of criminals in prison. And I'd like to just read something to you here, and I quote American Civil Liberties Union, and I quote, in recent years, the ACLU has not only led the fight to eliminate school prayer, but also has sought to remove under God from the Pledge of Allegiance. It is sought to end all federal fundings of military chaplains. It's demanded that the posting of the Ten Commandments be torn down from classroom walls. It has moved against the singing of Silent Night by students at Christmas time, and to end all Christmas plays and Easter pageants, and to remove the nativity scene from schools and public grounds. It's made voluntary prayer groups in schools subject to court suits. One Tennessee football team who said a prayer on the field prior to each game was made the target of a civil liberties suit, unquote. So you see what this ungodly, anti-Bible, anti-American, anti-God movement, the ACLU, is doing in this country. It's an organization that you need to take a stand against and expose it in every way possible, because they're doing much danger, doing much damage in the land. They're out to set criminals free, to turn loose men that ought to be in prison, to keep men out of the electric chair as well. Now the Bible said we're to be subject to the powers that be, of course, in Romans chapter 13. The powers that be, the powers are ordained of God. We couldn't get along in the world today unless we had some kind of organization of power to supervise and lead and set up standards. And we are to obey the powers that be. Now, of course, if the government, if the law of the land should demand that you do something completely contrary to the word of God, you have a perfect right not to do it. Meaning the Bible didn't do it. When they asked Daniel not to pray, passed the law that he shouldn't pray, he knew he should pray, and he prayed anyway. That's what I'm talking about, something similar to that. Now, according to the Bible, the father is the place of authority in the home. Now, we have those that rule in government. I mentioned them, the president, the governors, the senators, the congressmen, the mayors, and whatnot. And then the father is in the place of authority in the home. Some time ago, many years ago now, a woman came up to the late Dr. Bob Jones Sr. and said, Dr. Bob, I want you to pray for my boy. He's very rebellious. I can do nothing with him. I can't control him. I can't get him to obey me. I just can't get him to do right. I want you to pray for him. Dr. Jones said, "Lady, how old is that boy?" Oh, she said, he just turned 14. He said, "I won't pray for him." He said, "Why should I pray a prayer for a boy when a stick can take care of the situation?" Now, beloved, we need to realize that the father is in charge in the home, in the place of authority, and he can do some controlling in that home until those children are grown. That's his responsibility. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body." In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 1, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." God said that dad, that father in the home, he sits in the seat of authority. It's his responsibility to control that home. That wife is to be in subjection to her husband, and those children is to obey their parents in the Lord according to the Bible. And so fathers have that responsibility. Now, if you are not man enough to be a man and shoulder that responsibility and realize God's going to bring you to account for it in the day of judgment, then you better remain unmarried. When you get married, you're stepping in a position of a man. That's a man's position. If you get married, that you should be a real man and be the one that controls your home, because you're in the place of authority. If you don't do it, you're headed for trouble. Any home where the father is not the head of that home and not in authority, there's usually trouble in that home. Now, you must keep that in mind. And you to control your home till your children get up grown, old enough on their own to get out on their own, and then you to pray for them and advise and do the best you can. Now, the pastor, his place, of course, in the church is in the position of authority. That's why you have a pastor, because he's placed in the position of authority in the church. And God expects him to watch over the flock, to be a commander, a leader, and a guide in the church, and an overseer. That's a pastor's position. Now, if that pastor fails to do that, that is his responsibility. If he fails to do that, his church will eventually wind up in division and trouble and strife and whatnot. Now, the church is not to be run and organized by different groups in the church. It's to be led by the pastor and advised by the pastor, and he's to preach the word of God and tell the people what's right and what's wrong, and the church should follow his leadership as he follows the Lord. Now, if he doesn't assume that responsibility, if he doesn't cover all the ground he stands on, then sooner or later his church will be fouled up and crossed up, and you'll have people in the church like sheep running in every direction, not knowing which way to turn. God holds that pastor responsible. He'll answer to God for it in the day of judgment. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 28, "Take heed therefore unto yourselves all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood." When Paul left Ephesus here, he said to the pastors, he said, "Now I want you to take the oversight of your church, the flock of God, and feed those people. They are the overseers. The pastors are the overseers." Now, you know what an overseer is. If you've ever been employed in any kind of factory or place where you've earned your income, somebody's in charge. And the overseer's in charge. Now, the pastor is the overseer. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, "The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof." The Bible said the pastor is to take the oversight. And then in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 4, "Behold, I've given him for a witness to the people, a leader and a commander to the people." That's the pastor. That's his position. And a man that's not big enough and strong enough and brave enough to take that responsibility, he's got no business walking behind that sacred desk. There's churches all over the land today because the tail is wagging the dog. People in the audience are telling the preacher what he can do and what he can't do. Sometimes the case where deacons or elders or stewards try to tell the preacher how to operate the church and what he should do and what he should not do. And those churches are in a mess of confusion and all fouled up and crossed up and split up. And that pastor is the one to give an account unto God in the day of judgment for that situation. If you will check any church today, where they have the church all crossed up and split up and the tail wagging the dog, you're going to find that that preacher is not man enough to stand up and take command of the situation and lead his people and tell his people right from wrong. At any time a preacher goes into a church and they laid down to him a set of rules that's demanded by the church, he can't do this, he can't do that, and he's got to do this, he must do that. Brother, if he accepts that position, he's a hireling. He's not a man of God. The preacher is to get his orders from the Bible and from God and tell the people, and they're to follow his leadership as he follows the Lord. To be sure, the preacher's not a perfect man. He can make mistakes and he can make the wrong move. But it's a church responsibility to pray for him. And at any time that preacher makes the wrong move or makes a mistake or preaches something that you don't agree with him, then be a wise enough and a gentleman enough and ladylike enough to come and sit down and say, Pastor, I want to talk with you about this matter. You're not preaching the Bible as it is. I want to discuss thus and thus and find out why you're doing certain things. Now, you can do that. That's your privilege. And any pastor that's worth the salt goes in his bread will listen to you and talk with you about it. And if you can prove to him from the Word of God that you're right, and if he's wrong, if he's the right kind of preacher, he'll admit that he's wrong. And when you show him he's wrong from the Bible, preachers are not perfect. Some time ago, there's a preacher in the pulpit. He said, you know, we don't have any perfect people in the world. We most certainly don't. And one man raised his hand. He said, sir, can I hear from you? He said, yes, sir. He said, do you know of any perfect person in the world? The man said, yes, sir, I surely do. He said, well, will you stand to your feet and tell me who that perfect person is in the world that you know about? He'd be glad to. He stood up and said, it's my wife's first husband. Well, I think maybe he must have made a mistake there. People have their ideas about certain things, but there's no perfect people in the world. Jesus Christ, the only perfect one. The pastor's not perfect. The deacons are not perfect. The teachers or the members, they're not perfect by any means. But God is holding that pastor responsible. Now in the book of Revelation chapter 2 and 3, when God Almighty sent a message to the seven churches in Asia Minor, he sent that message to the pastor. And the position of that pastor was a star in his right hand, the place of authority. He sent the message to the pastor of each church. And God held that pastor responsible to see to it that church got that message. And God today still speaks to his church, his people, through the Word of God, through the pastor, as he preaches the Word of God. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, the Bible says, obey them that have rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give them account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, but that is unprofitable for you. So the Bible said, for you as a member, to obey those that have the rule over you, which is the pastor. Obey the Word of God as he gives it to you and follow his leadership as he follows the Lord. That's your responsibility. In Numbers chapter 12, we find that Miriam and Aaron rose up against Moses. I'm not saying that Moses was right in what he did. I'm not arguing that point. But they were wrong, and they thought they would correct him. And God said, you let him alone. He's my servant. I'll take care of him. And there he struck Miriam down with leprosy. And Moses had to pray that God would deliver her, which he did, and God did deliver. But they were wrong in trying to correct Moses, the man of God. And God said, I'll take care of my servants. They'll stand to fall before me. I'll handle them. The Bible says, don't bring any accusation against a preacher, except it be in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Never bring an accusation against a man of God unless you got two or three witnesses or more to prove your point. And so that minister's in the place of authority, and he has a great responsibility. He'll answer to God for it in the day of judgment. Now we're living in a day of much rebellion. Rebellion out here in the world. You know that. Rebellion in government. Rebellion in schools. Rebellion all over the land today. Men rebelling against authority. Crime on the increase. And criminals are being turned loose in the land today that ought to be in prison and ought to be sent to the electric chair. Now this Bible teaches capital punishment. I won't have time to give you all the scriptures and read them to you that I'd like to give you in regard to capital punishment, the death penalty. The Bible teaches a death penalty. The Bible says a man that deliberately and maliciously takes another man's life, He ought to be put to death. And we're doing wrong if we don't put those men to death. All over this nation today, you will find people on death row that's put people to death, will eventually be put in prison and eventually be out again on the streets. They should be put to death. They're kept in prison sometime 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years before they're really put in the electric chair. Not many of them electrocuted or put to death then, and it's wrong. God said their punishment is death. That is their punishment. When a man commits cold-blooded murder and he is a criminal, a cold-blooded killer, God said he is to be put to death. And if we fail to put that man to death, we're disobeying God. It will answer to it in the day of judgment. All judges, all lawyers, all jurors that turn them loose or have any part in it will answer God for it in the day of judgment. Jot these scriptures down on capital punishment, on the death penalty. Read them for yourself. That proves without a shadow of doubt the Bible teaches a death penalty. These little mealy-mouthed liberals and infidels and modernists today and that ACLU crowd and all that bunch that know nothing about God or the Bible that fight against the death penalty, they'll join hands with the devil and the communists and everybody else to fight against true Americanism, and it's dead wrong. Jot these scriptures down. Genesis chapter 9, verses 5 and 6. Genesis chapter 9, verses 5 and 6. Exodus chapter 21 and verse 12. Numbers chapter 35, verses 7 through 18. Deuteronomy chapter 19, verses 11 through 13. Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 41. Luke chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 7. All of these verses lets us know that cold-blooded murder should be put to death, and God has given the government authority to do so and expects the government to do so, those in authority, the government, the law of the land. God expects them to carry out the death penalty and put these criminals to death. Let me give you these figures. And the question is asked, is it a deterrent to crime? That is the death penalty a deterrent to crime? And this is taken from the Baptist Watchman in Elkin, Maryland. And I quote, "The question is frequently asked, is capital punishment a deterrent to crime? One thing is certain, it will deter the person who is put to death from committing any more crimes. But it is interesting to note that during the period from 1957 through 1964, there were 344 executions in the United States and 68,750 murders. And during the period from 1965 through 1981, there were only 14 executions and 298,160 cold-blooded murders. During the 8-year period from 1957 to 1964, there were 199 murders to every execution. During the 17-year period from 1965-1981, there were 21,297 murders for every execution." Unquote. Now you be the judge. Do we find that capital punishment, death penalty, deter crime? Certainly. Certainly, a man will have to be foolish to think it doesn't. It does deter crime. And we need to encourage capital punishment. You got men on death row today that ought to be put to death and put to death immediately. Been sitting there for years. And there's no point in keeping them there year in and year out. Need to do something about it immediately. The Bible is very clear on the death penalty, and you need to realize that. And everyone, whether it be a lawyer, or whether it be a judge, or whether it be in the jury box, and a man commits cold-blooded murder, and that man is not put to death by that jury or the judge or whatever the case may be, and that person is let loose and he goes out and he commits other crimes, the jury that failed to give him the death sentence, or the lawyer or the judge that fought that he might not be put to death, and that man commits other crimes, they're going to answer to God for every crime that person commits when he should have been put to death. Now, these people on the jury, they think they get him. I say, I can't stand the thought of saying that man ought to be put to death. If he's a cold-blooded murderer and you don't stand up for the death penalty, and you turn that man loose, put him in prison, he killed somebody in prison, he gets out and kills somebody on the outside, you that sat in that jury box and fail to give him the death sentence, you'll answer to God as well as that man will answer to God for the murder or for all the crimes that he committed because you fail to give him the death penalty being carried out. I feel sorry for these liberal lawyers and these liberal judges and the board that turned these men loose and the ACLU, bunch of cranky lunatics and all that crowd, I feel sorry for them. When they face God in the judgment, there'll be much blood on their hands. God help us realize there is a place of authority. It's to be enforced, to be carried out according to this Bible. And God's going to hold preachers and dads, and God's going to hold governors and mayors and presidents and senators and congressmen and law enforcement officers, all in authority. God's going to hold them responsible if they don't respond and carry out their responsibility according to this book. By the help and grace of Almighty God, I intend as a pastor to try to assume that responsibility that a pastor should assume in the pulpit. As long as I'm a pastor of the church, I intend to try to do that by the help of God Almighty, because I must face God in the judgment and give an account unto God for my ministry. And I don't want to be guilty of being nestled in that field and not being man enough to stand up and be the kind of preacher to tell the people, to help the people, to instruct the people, to warn the people, and tell them right from wrong. Because I'll have enough to face God about other than that. And I most certainly don't want to have to face God in that respect. A message like I brought this morning is not sweet. It's not enjoyable. But you'll have to admit it's needed. And I need about 2 hours to really get this message across. But I don't have that much time. But I hope I've said something to put you to thinking that'll help you as you sojourn. And then when you face God in the judgment, you'll be glad that you did. Let's stand to our feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it. We know a message like this sometimes hard to preach. Sometimes our Father is resented. Some people don't like to hear it. They'd much rather hear something that's blessed and uplifting. But our Father, you command us in your word to preach the whole counsel of God. And woe be unto the man that's called to preach that doesn't preach the whole counsel of God. Help me not to be guilty of failing to preach the whole counsel of God. Bless this people. Have you in the invitation, I pray in Christ's name. Amen. While Debbie plays, if you're here today, you're unsaved, you're backslidden, you want to come back to God, you want to join this church, if God moves on you to respond to this invitation, I want you to come. Play us a stanza, Debbie. Would you come while we wait? If God is speaking today, the way is open for you to respond. Be the reason you feel like you need to respond on. Is God speaking?